So let us start the lecture. We had started looking at curves in space, and we gave what is called the arc length parameterization for a curve in space. So let us recall what was the advantage of giving a curve arc length parameterization. We saw that if the curve is given arc length parameterization, then the rate of change is unit always. Okay. So that is why it is called unit speed parameterization. We had seen this proof earlier. Let us just recall that for a curve RT, if RS is the arc length parameterization, then the norm of dr by dt is equal to ds by dt. That follows obviously from the formula that S is equal to integral 0 to t norm of r prime u, and the arc length parameterization is always of unit length at every point. So just recall the proof. So since the length from 0 to t is given by this formula, so ds by dt is just the norm of the tangent. Okay. And by chain rule we saw that the dr by ds is nothing but 1 over r prime t, because the curve is regular, that is not equal to 0, and the length is equal to 1. Another advantage of arc length parameterization is that in case you are given a curve which has the property that it is unit speed, then it is essentially arc length parameterization. You don't have to convert it except for the initial point. So supposing a curve is given which is a smooth regular curve and its length at every point is 1, then we want to say this is essentially arc length parameterization, right? So that in that sense it is unique, except for initial point we have to choose. So for any point t0, if you choose, then you have to translate the time by t minus t0, where you start, that is the only doubt. So that is quite obvious from the definition of the arc length parameterization, because if S is the arc length parameterization for that curve, then that gives you, and this is equal to 1, right? Because you are given that dr by dt is equal to 1 for every point, so that gives you, this is equal to t minus t0, right? You fix your initial point, accordingly it gives you that S is equal to t essentially except for a translation of the initial point. And finally, we show that this arc length parameterization is in some sense invariant of the equivalence of curves. So if two curves have the same parameterization R1 and R2 which are equivalent, then they will give you the same arc length parameterization. So it doesn't matter which one you start with, okay, so you will get the same. So for that, we have to just observe if R1 is equal to R2, equal to meaning in the sense of equivalence, then we showed that the unit tangent vector to R1 and R2 are same except for a change of sign, right? So that is what we will use here. So dr1 by ds is just plus minus dr2 by ds. So you can see that the norm of both of them are same. And if you put the initial point to be same, then there will be unique arc length parameterization. So this is the advantage of having arc length parameterizations. Let us come, we saw that for a curve, smooth regular curve, r prime t gives you the tangent vector to the curve at any point, right? For a plane curve, if you know the tangent, you also know the normal vector to that curve, because the normal is again a vector in the same plane in which the curve is lying, and it is a line which is perpendicular to the tangent. But for a space curve, you know the tangent vector, what should be called as the normal to the curve. Now the problem comes, because in space this is the curve, a line, there are many lines which are parallel to it, right, perpendicular to it. So which one you would like to call as the normal to the curve? So there is a problem, right, to make it standardized. So for that we observe one thing, that the unit tangent vector has that property that its norm is always equal to 1. And what we are looking for? We are looking for a vector which you can say is the vector which is perpendicular to the curve, right? So we use a property that norm of the unit vector is, tangent vector is 1. So if you call that function as capital TT, then TT dot TT is equal to 1, right? Norm is equal to 1. So if you differentiate, you get tangent is perpendicular to something, and that vector we will call as the normal vector. So let us write this. So in the plane, we know how to define. So the problem comes in the, so for the plane, we know that there are two directions which can be called as the normal vectors. In space, there is a problem. So let us observe that for a unit tangent vector, this dot product is equal to 1. So, and this is a function of t, right? At every point, the norm is equal to 1, the unit tangent vector. So we can differentiate with respect to t and get t prime t dot, the unit tangent vector is 0. So we can say this is a unit, right? This is a tangent vector differentiated. So we can say we can call this as the normal to that, t prime t. That is perpendicular. So let us call t prime t divided by this to be the unit normal vector. So we'll say whenever we want to talk about a normal vector to a curve in space, we'll take this as the vector. And this is consistent with the definition of normal to a plane in the space, in the plane also. So both are consistent. So there is no problem. Let us look at the following problem: how this vectors, curves are going to help us. Suppose we have a surface in space, which is like a thin sheet kind of a thing, right? But that is not a straight sheet, it is bent, right? The sheet is bent and the top is also not straight, it is some curve. And the bottom also is some other curve, right? And we want to find what is the area of this kind of a sheet, right? There is a sheet which is a thin sheet, which looks like a plane sheet bent in some way. The base is a curve, the top is some function. We want to find its area. So how is that going to be done? So this is essentially the idea that let us take for the time being, this is a curve in the plane, okay? And so along the base of the curve, something is rising, right? A surface is rising with a base in the curve as C. So at every point, we have to tell you what is the height. The height is given by a function z is equal to fxy, right? And we want to say what is the area of this surface. We want to find the area. So intuitively, what you will do to find this area, we'll try to approximate. So we'll take a small portion of the curve, right? That is a base. On that, take a vertical strip, okay? Find the area of that vertical strip, add up all these areas and try to sum it up. Right, that's what we will try to do. So if we do that, let us take a small portion of the curve, so that is say ds, and the height at that point will be f of xy. So let us, so the, what will be the area? So area will be given by fxy into delta s. Delta s is the small portion of the curve, small length of the curve over which you are raising. And if you want to now find out the total area, you will try to sum it up, right, and then try to take limit of delta s goes to 0, right, intuitively. So that limit, whenever that exists, is called the line integral of the function f over the curve C. So intuitively, that is a motivation coming from. So let us, and that is denoted by f integral over the curve C ds, d small s. That indicates you are integrating over a curve, right? So let us try to make it more precise, this intuitive idea from geometry. Let us make it more precise. So mathematically, you will write this as a definition as follows. C is a curve in space. We are always assuming our curves are smooth, regular curves with arc length parameterization, right, ds. So we are looking at the arc length parameterization, which is given by RAB to R3, right? And there is a function f defined in a domain D, which includes that curve, that base of the, right? The function is going to be defined on the curve, the height. So the domain of the function includes that image of the path of the curve. So in that case, what do we get? Let us combine these two functions. S is the curve. S belong to AB. S going to RS. That is a point in D. And there you have got a function. So here is the interval A to B, here is the point S. So it is, goes to a curve C. So that gives you a point here, that is RS. And on this, there is a function defined f of xy. If it's two variables, so f of xy. So that is a function in R. So if I combine this, what do I get? I get a composite function S goes to f of RS. Right? There is a function from AB to R. And we want to integrate that function simply, right? That will be the area of the curve. So let us write that. So look at the function s going to f of rs, the composite function. This is a function defined on the interval a, b. It is a continuous function, so it is integrable. So we denote the integral of this. On the right hand side is the integral of function of one variable only. That integral is called the line integral of f over the curve c. Okay? Is quite clear to everybody? Mathematically what we are doing? Intuitively, the idea is to find the area of something. We had already done area below the graph of a function in one variable, but the base was a straight line there. Here the base may not be a straight line, it is a curve. That is the only difference coming. So this new integral comes. So that is the integral of function f. F is a scalar valued function, so it is called the line integral of f over the curve c. Okay? And if your curve happens to be a closed curve, then we specify in the integral itself by putting a circle here that indicates that the domain over which you are integrating that curve is actually a closed curve. So the notation itself will explain to you whether you are integrating an ordinary curve or a closed curve. So this is a notation when C is a closed curve. So this is writing the integral, defining what is called the line integral in terms of arc length parameterization. So our definition depends on the curve being given in arc length parameterization. Supposing we don't have arc length parameterization, so one possibility is you take the curve, write down the arc length parameterization, and then compute the integral. But you don't have to do that much, because what is your integral? It is ds. But ds you can write as ds by dt into dt. You can use a change of variable formula. From s, you can go to the variable t by going to that arc length parameterization. So we can write down the formula straight away, that if a function is given which is continuous and C is a simple closed, simple regular curve given by a parameterization over some CD, then the line integral of f over C is given by f evaluated at with respect to that parameterization. Earlier it was f of RS because that was the parameterization. Now the parameterization is f of XT, YT, ZT. Earlier it was DS, but we already know DS by DT is equal to norm of r prime t into dt. So change of variable substitution, if you want to call it, in one variable gives you that this should be the formula. Proof is obvious, right? Because ds by dt is equal to this factor r prime t norm dt. So that proof one can write down. So keep in mind this is equal to this and ds by dt is equal to this. So these two combined together give you a proof of that. So if asked for why this is equal, don't write this is obvious. Right? This is the proof to be written. Okay? Why? They give the reason why for arbitrary parameterization this is given by this. So this is the reason for that. Okay? If asked for in an exam. And this is the reason also for that. Okay. Let us observe a few things about this line integrals. See, when we said we look at the given the parameterization as arc length parameterization, S going to RS, right? Intuitively, in our mind, we always had that as S increases, as the time increases, the arc length is going to increase, right? The length of the curve is going to increase. We have already kept that in mind, because what is that dr by ds? That is equal to the norm of something. That is, we have taken the positive sign. But you could have taken the negative sign there, negative vector, if you wanted, right? So we took the attitude that we are looking at curves in the format that as time increases, RS, the arc length is also going to increase. But you can have, so this is, so what is the meaning of saying as S increases, RS increases? You are putting a direction on the movement of the particle. You are putting a direction on the movement of the particle on that curve, on that path. From here to here you are going, or you want to go from opposite side you want to go. Right? So if you take the opposite one, then only a negative sign will come in the integral sign. So when you are going increasing arc length with increase of variable, that is called positive orientation on the curve. Right? So our all formulas till now given are with respect to positive orientation on the curve. RS increases as S increases. So that is the note, positive orientation. Opposite one is called opposite orientation or negative orientation, whatever you want to. Let us just look at some examples to fix this idea of calculation of line integrals. We want to calculate the integral of the function 1 plus x y square ds over the line integral over the curve C, where C is the curve joining the point 0, 1 with the point 1, 2. So what should be the first step in computation? You have to give first of all a parameterization for the curve, because all computations are done in terms of parameterizations. So this is a straight line. So at any point, how do you give parameterization? Take any point here, see the relation between x and y coordinate, because x and y will determine what is the line. So what is the relation between x and y? What is the equation of this line? Y equal to 2x. So you can give a parameterization. You can treat x as a variable itself. So xt equal to t, yt equal to 2t, and t goes from 0 to 1. So that is a parameterization for the curve. So the parameterization is given by rt is equal to t times I plus 2t times j, t between 0 and 1. Once the parameterization is written, rest is only a minor job of computing. So compute the norm of this, right? So first find the derivative and then compute the norm of that, norm of r prime t that is going to appear in our calculations. So that you compute is square root of 5. So you get the formula, this line integral is equal to, write this function f in terms of xt, yt and zt. So that is the function, into the norm of r prime t, square root of 5 dt, and compute that integral. Right? So as far as computing the line integral is concerned, you have to decipher, you have to give a parameterization for the curve. That is important. For example, let us compute. This is, I have given you a picture about only about two variables, but this works even for three variables, right? There is no problem. A curve in space is a function from an interval AB into R3, and the function is defined on the curve in R3 to R, so you can compose and integrate, right? So that line integral works, the same definition is works for even for functions which are scalar value defined in R3, curves in space, no problem. So let us compute this, where the curve is given by the circle, okay, circular helix, cos t I plus sin t j plus t times k, you are varying from 100 to minus 105. So remember the circular helix? Yes? Even if you don't remember the picture, you can compute, but it's always good to remember the picture of next. Okay, let me draw the picture itself. I can't change. So, a circular helix was a point starts here and goes winding around, right? So, it starts at, so our point is, what is the point? 100. So, this is the x axis, this is y axis, and this is z axis. So it starts at this point, which is 100. Up to what point we have to go on the circular helix? Minus 1 0 pi. So where will be that point? -1. So on the x axis, if you want to project that point onto the xy plane, the coordinates are going to be -1 0. So that point is going to be on the x axis on the other side, okay, at a distance of -1. Okay, so that is going to be the point, and projected onto the xy plane. So this is the point. Okay, when projected onto the xy plane, it lands up on the negative side of the x axis at the point -1, 0. And the height z axis, this height is nothing but that is pi, right? It has gone, height has gone up pi. It has landed on the other side of the x axis of projection. So that is the. But if you even if you don't want to compute or don't want to see the picture, you can write down from here. You have to see from here, from where does t vary, right? For the curve, the portion of the curve that you are looking at, right? To move from this point to this point, you have to decide t goes from where to where, because you have to integrate, right? F of xt, yt, zt, r prime t norm dt from t equal to a to b. So for this case, it goes from 0 to pi. So that is a, so once you have determine that, find the norm from 0 to 2 pi and compute, put down the values and compute. Okay. Right. Now, as far as the line integral is concerned, it is an operation, right? Integration like differentiation, integration also is an operation. What you are doing? You are taking a function f, a scalar field and integrating it over a curve C. You get an answer which is a number. So it is a function, you can think it as an operator which is defined on the class of all. Sorry. Right. I am extremely sorry for this short disruption, which was not called for commercial break, uncalled for commercial break, but it was a break anyway. Good. So let us come back to, yes, let us come back, break is over, okay. Let us come back to the line integral. It is an operation defined on all scalar fields on R2 or R3, and it gives you a number, right. So we want to know how does it behave with respect to operations on scalar fields. You can take two scalar fields, like ordinary integration, you can add scalar fields, you can multiply scalar field by another thing, you can change the domain of integration. Instead of a curve C, you can take join two curves and integrate over them. So we would like to know how this behaves, and we are seeing that as far as computation is concerned, it is only integration of one variable, f of xt, yt, zt, something norm of r prime t dt. So it perfectly behaves like function of one variable. So integral of two scalar fields f and g, line integral over c, splits as integral over c of f plus integral over of g over c. So linearity property, if you multiply by a scalar alpha times f, the new scalar field, its line integral is alpha times, okay. And this is something which we are not proving, but it is intuitively quite clear, like we do for a function of one variable. If your function is continuous in one portion and continuous in the next portion, you can write down the integral over the whole interval as integral over the first plus integral over the second. Similarly, if your curve C consists of a finite number of pieces, right, that means at finite number of points, the curve is probably not differentiable, or it is not smooth or not regular. You can divide your curve into pieces so that each piece is a regular curve. Then the line integral over C, you can write it as summation over line integral of all individual pieces put together, right? So like function of one variable, same properties. So for example, let us try to integrate this function in f over c. Fx, yz is given some function of three variables, and the path is, it's going from along y equal to x square from 0, 0, 0 to the point 1, 0, 0. Right, you go along this path, and then from this point A, you go to a point B along the line segment joining A with B. So what you are doing, your curve consists of two parts. You go along one path, C1, and then go along another path, C2. But C1 is a curve, y equal to x square, right? If you just write y equal to x square, what does it look like? If I don't give you anything else, y equal to x square is a? It's not a parabola. It's a parabola sheet, right? This is the projection onto the xy plane. So it will be parabolic sheet. But we are saying, you look at the curve in this part only, 0, 0, 1, 2. So you are looking at the part only in the plane. So you are moving in the plane from 0, 0, 0 to A, right? You go to this point, and from this point, you go up along this line, okay? So that is the integral we want to compute. So go along the parabola and then go up. So you have to give for each part a parameterization, y equal to x square, you are remaining in the xy plane, so z is equal to 0. So what is the parameterization of the part C? A parameterization for the part C, x, y square, z is 0. So you can write rt is equal to t, ti plus t square j plus 0 times k. What about this portion? In this portion, what is varying? Only z is varying, right? The base remains constant. So what is it? One t. But as a, you should write it as a parameter t. So it is I plus j plus t times k, right? So that is the parameterization. Once the parameterization is known, you can compute the integrals, okay? So these are the two parameterizations. So compute integral over C1, compute integral over C2 and add. Okay, so let us just complete that. Integral over C1. So on C1, write the function in terms of t, xt, yt, zt. Write down norm of r prime t dt, and similarly for the second part, and compute that integral, whatever that value comes out to be. So basically, what we are doing is, we are looking at, important thing to remember is, for line integrals, as far as computation is concerned, a parameterization is a paramount thing, right? Just knowing the geometric object, that this is the path, is no good. You have to have a parameterization for that path. Once you have parameterization, you can compute, you can do analysis on them. Okay? So let us look at, I said that the negative orientation kind of thing, right, going backward. So let us describe, for a given curve from a point A to B, what is the parameterization of the curve traveling that curve backwards. So R is a curve, R of t belonging to AB, right, initial point is R of A, final point is R of B. I want to traverse this path backwards. I want to start at B, I want to come back at A, right, so initial point I want it to be B and final point to be A. So what should be the parameterization? Without looking, try to see whether you get the same answer or not. T equal to 0, you want to start there. T equal to A, right? It is writing the equation of the line backward, essentially. You can try to write that for a line interval, okay, A to B, try to write going backwards at any point in that, and what is the point backward. So this is the parameterization for that. So you can see that all is not that trivial all the time, right? You have to put in some mind to write down this equation. Okay, so this is the parameterization. Now let us see whether actually you get the negative sign. As I said, if you change the orientation going forward to backward, this is a backward one, what will be the line integral compared to the earlier one? We should get a negative sign. Do you think we'll get it? So let us see. Okay, so this is also a smooth curve. Path of the two are same. If you look at the path, it's like a train going from Kanjurmarg to CST, and the other train coming from CST to Kanjurmarg on the same path. So that is the reverse, and the claim is, if a function f has a line integral over C, yes, please come back to lecture. If a function has a line integral over C, that means this quantity exists, right, appropriate conditions, then its integral over the curve minus C, the reverse orientation, also exists and is minus of the original one, right? What is the, for the reverse orientation, what is the unit tangent vector? Or tangent vector r prime, it is negative, but as far as integration is concerned, you are going to look at only norm of that, so norm is not going to change, norm is same. So from where does the negative sign come? Yeah, but mathematically we know direction is negative, so mathematically what is happening when you write integral of f ds over this new path, you are going to write integral is going to be, instead of a to b, initial point to final point, it is going to be B to A, F of, in terms of T, norm R prime T or R tilde T, they are same, DT. So when you have integration B to A, that gives a negative sign from A to B, right? The tangent vector is opposite direction, but the norm is same, that does not change the integral. So that is the important thing. So as far as this integral is concerned, right, that nothing changes except for, in terms of one variable, it is going from B to A. So this integral is minus of integral from A to B, which is integral of the line integral of F over C. So that's why the negative sign is coming. Okay? So what we have done, we have tried to integrate a scalar field over a line, right? Now let us try to extend this idea a bit further, and to see why we want to extend that, let us consider this problem. A body is being moved by a force. A force is being applied to a body. The body starts moving. It moves along a particular path, right? We want to know, if you move from some time point say t equal to t0 to some time point t equal to t1, how much work you will be doing in moving that body against that force that you are applying, right? The physical quantity of work done, we want to write it mathematically, right? So let us see the problem, what is coming. So this is the point, you are moving along this curve, the body is moving along this curve. At this point, you apply a force F, right? And you move it by a small distance. So how much is the work done? We know that if you apply a force and the body moves in a straight line, if you know the distance, the force into the distance gives you the amount of work done. But here the line is not a straight line. It is some curve. So we try to approximate. That is what we always try to do. So imagine a small portion of the curve, right? Length, we can call it as delta S. And if the length is delta S, we can treat that small portion as a line segment. A force is being applied, but along which direction? Along which direction you are applying the force? What is the direction? At this point, you are applying a force and the body is moving along the curve. So what you will do? Dot product of what with what? Force with? So what you should do? Okay, so let us compute. So F dot, this is the direction, right? This will be the direction along which you will be applying the force. Force is always tangential to the body. So you have to look at the tangential component of the force. Okay, not the force itself, the tangential component of the force. There is a tangential component of the force. By a distance delta S, you are moving it. So this is the amount of work done by moving along a small path. Okay, small portion of the curve. If you want the total work done, what you should be doing? You should integrate this. So let us write the integral. So total work done will be this integral. So F dot, now this is a scalar function. Keep in mind, F is a vector valued function. Force. Force has a magnitude and a direction. This is a vector valued field. Right? Vector field is a vector valued function. R prime, that is a vector function. So you're taking the dot product, you're getting a scalar field, and you're integrating the scalar field over that curve, C. Okay? And that is 0 to T1 ds. But what is ds? You want to integrate that, right? Actually, I should write here over C, right? Time has not entered into picture. But what is ds? If you want to actually compute, in terms of t, you want to write ds is ds by dt multiplied by dt. And what is ds by dt? So that r prime t and r prime t cancels. So you can write as f dot r prime t dt. Is that okay for everybody? So amount of work done, either you write this or you write this as F dot ds, okay, or dr. So this is the amount of work done. So this motivates a definition. So if rt is a curve, okay, let us define, you have got a vector field, you got a scalar field. Let us define it for a scalar field first. For a scalar field, let us define f dx. Okay, I'm just introducing some notations now. To write that integral of a vector field over a line integral, I want to introduce some notations. For a scalar field F, I want to write what is F of dx instead of F of ds, okay, over C. So what is that notation going to be? This is integral, which is the integral of one variable, F of x dy zt, dx by dt. You are moving only along x direction of that curve, okay, only one direction. Similarly, the second one, the y direction, and the third one, z direction, right? Once you have these notations, f dx, so that is only dx by dt, right? Similarly, dy. Now, for a vector field, this helps us to write that integration of the vector field. For a vector field f with components f1 and f2 and f3, what was that work done? Said it should be, integral should be f dot dr dash dt. But what is dr dash? That is x prime t I plus y prime t j plus z prime t k. So f dot, that what will that give you? F x prime dt, f, right, f2 y prime t dt, and similarly third one. So you are getting those three integrals just now. I wrote integral of f1 dx, line integral of f1 dx plus line integral of f2 dy plus line integral of f3 dz. So this vector field, we write f dot dr, the line integral over c, is written as this: f1 of dx, f2 of this should be dy, f3 of dz. And what is this three integrals? This is just f1 dx by dt. If you know the parameterization of the curve, you can write down this integral: f of xt yt zt evaluated at that point, dx by dt into dx, evaluated from appropriate limits of t, similarly the other ones. But this is a very convenient way of writing this line integral of a vector field, and which helps you to determine what is physical quantity, like the work done and some other applications. We'll see it later on. Okay. So once again, this depends on the orientation, right? In which way you are moving. If you change the opposite one, you will get a negative sign, positive or negative. So let us write down some examples for this. Okay. Let us look at C1 and C2 are two smooth curves, where R1 is this one, R2 is this one. Okay. You can recognize R1 is nothing but the straight line, R2 is something else. The projection onto the xy plane is a parabola, but if you look at z, that is going much rapidly higher, right? It is cube, at the rate of cube. So these are two different curves. Both are regular curves. Both start at, what is R1 at 0? That is 0. R1 at 0 is also 0. R1 at 1, that is 1, 1, 1. For this, R1 at 1 is 1, 1, 1. So both have same initial point, same final point. So I got two different curves, right? Starting at the same point, ending at the same point. Let us find the work done in moving a body along these two different curves. What do answer we get? Okay. So the both are from 0, 0, 1 to 1, 1, 1. So let us look at, so this is the vector field I want to integrate, yzi xzj plus x square y k. Right. So what is f1? Yz. What is f2? Xz. What is f3? X square y. So line integral of this over the curve C1 will be equal to, right, of F1, so that is YZ, okay, DX, F2, DY, F3, DZ. So let us compute that, okay. So now, right, since we know Y and Z, all this in terms of parameters, we can write down, right, what is X? What was X in the first case? XT equal to? Xt is equal to t, right? So we know what is dx by dt. Okay, so dx by dt is equal to 1. So that way, same way you compute dy by dt and dz by dt. So all these three things you can write in terms of t only. So that is the integral that comes out to be this answer, right? You are treating x as a variable itself, dx by dt, dx. Similarly, let us compute over the other one, c2. So same way you will do it. So f1 dx, f2 dy, f3 dz, right, in terms of t, dx by dt into dt and so on, compute, that comes out to be 11 by 10. So both answers are same. What was the previous one? 10, same? 12, so they are different. So what does it say? It says the amount of work done along different paths need not be same, right? Physically you may think these are two paths joining 0, 0, 0 with 1, 1, 1, and suppose you come back by the other path, then you are not gone anywhere, you have not done no work, if you think physically, right? You have taken, you have done, moved a body along one path and come back to the same point, you may think that you have not done any work, but this says yes, you have done some work, right? So what does it say? That the line integral is not only dependent on the direction. Even if you have one curve, you are moving from A to B or moving B to A, right? That introduces a negative sign in the line integral. That is one. And the line integral is not always independent of the path joining two points. And this example shows it can depend upon, in fact, it does depend upon the points joining, the path joining two points. So that raises a natural question which we will tackle, which is a very important question. under what conditions you can say that the line integral is independent of the path joining two points. It does not depend upon, you take two points, whichever path you take, you get the same answer. If you can say, you can find a condition for that, that will be very useful, because you may have a very complicated path going and you want to integrate about that. But if you have that property, if that condition is satisfied, then you can as well take a straight line. Computation will become much nicer, right? We'll come to that. So as I said, some applications, let us just state about this line integrals. The first one was the area of a thin sheet, right? Physically, that motivated us to define the line integral. So let us just look at an example of this kind of a thing we want to compute. Okay? There is a there are two surfaces, one cut by the other, okay, and we want to find the area of that surface which is trapped between the two. Okay, so let us write the required area is over that curve of see, what you are going to do in this kind of a thing, look at the curve of the intersection. Okay, from this point you are going up to a height only if you are looking at the portion of that. Okay, so that is given by the line integral, and you compute, because the projection is the circle, and from that circle, right, there is a circular thing, and then there is a parabola cutting it. Parabola sheet is cutting it. So up to that height you are going to go. So that is the, so that gives a line integral. So computation of that, that we have already seen. Or this can also be useful in computing. You have got a thin wire, right, which is not in a plane, a thin wire in space, right, a bent kind of a wire. You want to find what is the total mass of that wire, provided you know what is the mass per unit length, right, density of that. So once you know the density, do you take a small piece? If the density is rho, take a small piece delta s. So what will be the mass of that small piece? Rho times delta s. If you want the total mass, you integrate over the line integral over, right, integrate the density over density function over the path, over that thin curve, whatever that thin line or thin metallic wire is there. Once you can do find the mass, you can also find the center of gravity of such a kind of a thing, right? So what is center of gravity for such a thing? It is a point where you can assume the whole mass to lie. So if that is the point, then the moment of that mass should be same with respect to the moment of the wire. That is a physical definition of center of gravity. What is center of gravity? Center of gravity is that point where you can assume the whole mass to be concentrated, right? So if the whole mass is concentrated at a point x bar, y bar, you can find its moments around the axis, right? Or on any axis you like. That is the mass into the distance. That will give you the moment around that axis. Or you, here if it's a three-dimension thing, you can find moments around a plane, xy plane, yz plane, and zx plane. But you can also take a small portion of that object, the thin wire, find its mass, and take its moment around that plane. And you want the total, you want the total moment, that will be an integral, right? So for a small mass, if you take the, say, around the xy plane, you take a small portion of the wire, what will be the distance of a small portion? That will be the z coordinate of that point, z into rho xyz into delta s. That gives you the moment of the small piece. Integrate it out, you get the total moment around the xz plane, right? Like we done it in two dimension and three dimension, two variables and three variables, right? Same idea. So let us just write. Okay, so this is a thin wire, and you want to compute its, say, mass. So delta m is the density into the small portion. Okay, so that total mass will be given by the line integral of the density function over the curve C, right? If you want to find center of, you can find for this thin wire the moment about the xy plane, right? So take a small portion delta s, its distance from the xy plane will be equal to z into the density. So what is this quantity? That is the moment of the small portion of the curve delta s around the xy plane, right? And this gives you the total moment, and that should be equal to the moment calculated from center of gravity. And what is the center of gravity says? The mass can be assumed to be at a point z bar. Total mass is m. Mz bar is equal to this quantity. So that gives you what is z bar. What is z bar equal to? This moment divided by the total mass. Total mass we have already calculated. So it is two line integrals, one divided by the other. So these are the coordinates of center of gravity. Okay, where this was the moment that we just now wrote. So that was right, and similarly the other ones. So just now we said you can also calculate what is the total amount of work done by using. All those were done in integrating scalar fields. Work done is computed by integrating a vector field, right? So we have two kind of line integrals. One is integrating a scalar field, other is integrating a vector field. Integrating a scalar field, FDS. And what is that integral? We write a parameterization for the curve RT. So f of xt, yt, zt into norm of r prime t dt. That gives you the line integral of a scalar field. What is the line integral of a vector field F, capital F, with components F1, F2 and F3? Its line integral is F1 dx plus F2 dy plus the line integral F3 dz, where dx is interpreted as dx by dt into dt if you know the parameterization of the curve, right? And both have physical applications, and some of them we have discussed today. So let us stop it here.